Hello guys, today we are continuing the subject we are covering for a few weeks now. We feel it's quite important for you to understand how the history of Pripyat and Chernobyl nuclear power plant influenced the later events, including, of course, the disaster. It may be surprising for you just how many different levels were connected, and how easily we can all speculate on the infamous events when it comes down to understanding the people, decisions, and technology behind them. That's why in the last four episodes we have covered the perspectives of politics, economics, and a particular person, Viktor Brukhanov, who we may call a godfather of Pripyat. Be sure to watch the previous four parts after watching this one to get a better context for what we will tell you today. Now, grab some snacks, sit comfortably, and enjoy the fifth part of our miniseries. History of Pripyat, Part 5. The Creation. When Viktor Brukhanov had finally overcome the first obstacles in fulfilling the ambitious plans sanctioned by high party officials from Moscow, he had to develop an even more important thing, the realistic approach. When we speak about any plans in the Soviet Union, please remember that they often were motivated by political or even personal desires of either the majority of the most important party members or a single one who had a sufficiently high rank. It was mostly because of unrealistic expectations that were driven by, again, unrealistic plans or goals of the Communist Party. Often those didn't include an actual state of things, like materials, specialists or civil matters. And since the whole system relied on the pyramid of reports, these plans often could not be fulfilled. For example, there could be a building site which ran out of concrete because of the shortages in the whole Soviet Union, so it wasn't completed for years, for it wasn't anywhere near high priority, or even not at all. The pyramid of reports is an unofficial term. I just thought it describes the situation in the political system very well. You see, if there was a high party official, he didn't gather the information himself. He was too busy being a career politician. He had to rely on the reports and information given to him by people beneath him, lower in rank. But they also didn't gather the information themselves. Again, they relied on other people's reports too. As he was their mentor and kind of promoter, he would hire people that maybe were not the best, but they were loyal, and they knew it. Because of that vicious circle, the actual state of matters, for example in Ukraine at that time, was often misunderstood or even falsely reported, just to be sure everybody achieved their own plans and goals. For example, it wasn't anything unusual for a factory to report that it has produced twice or triple the amount of what it actually produced. Often because even if they could produce that much, they didn't have the materials to do so. But that didn't bother anyone in Moscow. Steal, rob, kill, but do as you were told. And after that short summary of the political and economic system of the USSR, let's get back to the miniseries' main character, Viktor Brukhanov. We will speak about the first settlers in the next episode so that we can now do a small fast forward to the times when the actual construction of both Pripyat and Chernobyl nuclear power plant was in progress. Imagine you being a director of the power plant that doesn't even have any other workers, and after months of debates, it just got its name officially confirmed. You don't have any specialists hired, any construction workers, not even an accountant. You don't get paid, because you didn't hire the accountant. You have to be in charge of constructing the biggest and one of the most modern nuclear power plants in the whole world. Or at least you were just told so. But you don't have the materials. The only good thing is that you have a fairly big credit assigned to the project by a state bank. You have to fit in a budget, yet it's almost impossible to predict what specialists, materials or even devices will be available. Despite your support in Moscow, you still have to take the field arm of the Communist Party in Ukraine into consideration, which isn't happy to share the scarce resources they have. In the 1970s, the USSR was already under the weight of central planning, crippling and corrupted bureaucracy, and spending almost every penny on the military, including the Race to the Stars. That times were later named the Era of Stagnation. Being responsible for such an ambitious project, Brukhanov was both frustrated and disoriented by disbelief. Here he was, in Ukraine, building one of the most important power plants in the whole USSR, and he didn't even have enough construction equipment. The building materials were either always delivered late or didn't even come. Those that did arrive were often of extremely poor quality and defective. The reinforced concrete and pipes were so useless they were often just thrown away. Some of the most important materials for a power plant were in short supply, like steel, zirconium or copper. And this wasn't a regular building site. Some parts of the power plant had to be constructed step by step, so any shortage or delay often meant the construction of the whole sections was on hold for weeks. The economic state and the whole atmosphere in the USSR were so bad that they reflected on the quality of workmanship too. All manufacturing was so poor that Brukhanov, as well as any other person with a similar task in the Soviet Union, had to include something known as pre-installation overhaul in his plans. Imagine, after years of fighting for any part of needed materials and construction, you have to add weeks or months just to check if everything is in order. That pre-installation overhaul was nothing else than a stage where every piece of equipment had to be stripped down to the last screen cable, checked for any damages or faults, repaired, and then reassembled as the original specifications said. This meant that before the start, the whole power plant equipment had to be checked. Every switch, every gear, every system and every light bulb. It says a lot about the USSR planning, doesn't it? In July 1972, Viktor Brukhanov drove to Kiev to meet his current employer and boss, the Minister of Energy and Electrification. It was less than 3 years since he became the director of Chernobyl nuclear power plant, but it still wasn't finished. The decision was made. He planned to resign. Thank you for watching, this was the 5th part of our full history of Pripyat. Be sure to check previous episodes of this mini-series on our channel or watch other videos from our Chernobyl Stories playlist. That's it for today, guys. Take care, stay safe, and see you next week.